Okay, then let's continue. Today in the morning we should finish with a source space analysis. There was something left over from yesterday, and then after that we will discuss frequency space analysis for EEG. And I think this will be then the program for this morning, so that in the afternoon we start with the introduction to fMRI. So, first a brief reminder. So the basic idea about source space analysis is that one aims to project EEG activity, which is of course recorded on the scalp using electrodes, as you now know, into the brain, and in this kind of data analysis tries to find the spatial anatomical origin of some EEG activity. And so that's what source space analysis is all about. And this whole thing rests on the idea of the dipole that is corresponds to this basic biological model of EEG related activity. And then there are two problems, like we discussed yesterday. So the first problem is to actually evaluate electrode potentials if you know that somewhere in the brain there is activity. Of course, this is not special to EEG and the brain. So this is just the problem of if you have some electrical activity somewhere, and this is in some conductive medium, to evaluate the potential at a given distance from this original location. And in EEG, this is referred to as the forward problem, and is non-trivial to solve, so is based on standard physics solutions to this, and their mathematical solution in terms of the numerical solution of partial differential equations. And the other problem that is then of course more of interest to cognitive neuroscientists maybe is to, based on some observed EEG data, infer where the main activity is located. And of course this is then always conditional on the solution of the forward problem, because the solution of the forward problem is an essential part of solving the inverse problem. However, there are different ways that the inverse problem can be solved or worked with, even if the same forward problem solution is being used. So this is kind of the visual representation of forward and inverse problem. And central to this whole thing is the dipole that we discussed is induced, or is thought to be induced by excitatory postsynaptic potentials or inhibitory postsynaptic potentials, giving rise to extracellular currents and sync source configurations, which then propagate to the scalp and can be detected in EEG electrodes. And from a technical perspective, such a dipole is specified at a given time point by six numbers, namely where it is located in 3D space, or where it is located in the brain, which is the same thing, and three numbers that describe the moment of the dipole, which specifies its spatial orientation, because at this point in space here, you can of course have a dipole pointing this way or pointing this way. The dipole can be strong in the sense that it's a long arrow, or can be short. So you need another three numbers to specify the moment. And this dipole model, and the fact that if you have multiple dipoles in some medium, the activities of these dipoles this is behind all of EEG source localization and source analysis. And then we get yesterday already introduced that there are these two things: equivalent current dipole approaches, distributed source reconstruction, and we discussed the equivalent current dipole model, where for a given localization, U here is the dipole position, the forward problem solution yields a lead field matrix that then just needs to be multiplied with the moment to observe, to get an electrical potential pattern, in the sense that you get an electric potential for each electrode, but we're talking all the time about a single time point, hence I wrote this function of t in there. Yeah, and the way this is then done is that you obviously, if you have a single dipole trying to explain some observed data, is that you have to figure out which parameters, so which locations, which locations in x, y, and z space, and which moments are most likely to give rise to this observed pattern. And then this works usually in this setting, because it's nonlinear in the dipole position, because the forward problem solution is complex and nonlinear. And this works by numerically changing around values of the location and comparing the result of the prediction of the model with the observed data, and then changing the parameters, so location and moments, in such a way that the prediction error between predicted data and observed data is minimized. It's a little bit weird to introduce such a fundamental problem in this way. On the other hand, it's fairly cognitive neuroscience style, so that kind of general data analysis problems show up under kind of strange idiosyncratic labels like equivalent current dipole fitting, and seem kind of special to equivalent current dipole fitting, but this whole approach is very general, and we will discuss this and see it many times in statistical methods. So what was left in terms of source space analysis was actually to talk about distributed source reconstruction. So are there questions left from yesterday that you would like to clarify? Nope, doesn't seem to be the case. So then we now change to or finish EEG source analysis, talking about distributed source reconstruction, which is actually not that long. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. One characterization of distributed source approaches is that one has many more parameters than data points. So the characteristic feature of a distributed source reconstruction approaches is that you don't postulate one dipole, or two, or three, or six dipoles somewhere in the brain with certain orientations giving rise to the observed pattern. But what you do is you treat the entire 3D space as a grid of voxels, if you want, and at each of these locations you assume that there's a dipole. So you basically don't have the question of where should the dipole be located. You don't fit the position, because the position of all dipoles is fixed, and of course it depends on how many dipoles you want to use. So you can have very high resolution and you have many dipoles in 3D space, where you have fewer, but definitely you have many. The only thing that is then of interest is, of course, not where the dipoles are located, because you already say they are located throughout the brain volume, because you try to model essentially the entire cortex. But the question is, what are the moments of these dipoles? So how are they oriented, and what is their amplitude? And if you, for example, think that you have throughout the brain, you use 10 times 10 times 10 dipoles, then you, so in 3D space, then you would have 1,000 dipoles. And you, for each of those, you have three numbers. So you have 3,000 parameters, and these 3,000 parameters you try to determine from the 64 usually or 128 electrode data points that you have. So you have, if you want an ill-posed problem, you have many more parameters than data points. And again, here, this such a problem has non-unique solutions, meaning that certain moment profiles of these dipoles will yield the same prediction on the EEG electrode level, and hence if you have a certain EEG electrode level activation pattern, then it's not clear which of these solutions now is appropriate. And whenever this is happening, so if you have ill-defined models, it always sounds a little, to me, ill-defined still sounds as if the model is somehow wrong. But the model is not wrong, it's just a model that has many parameters. To be able to identify these parameters and have unique solutions, you need constraints. And these distributed source reconstruction approaches are usually classified according to their constraints. So one can, so these are three, maybe four, and many more variants. Examples for constraints. So one thing one can do in terms of the data analysis is to constrain the dipoles that one thinks have a non-zero moment to cortex. So that would essentially mean that if one has either one assumes kind of a standard brain where one puts the dipoles that one is interested in, or one uses some MR data and a specific 3D reconstruction of cortex of a given participant to do that. I think it's actually not the most common thing, although it sounds like the neurobiologically most sensible thing to do. I can't say that I've seen cortical constraint solutions that often what you see a little bit more often are things like minimum norm solutions that like in any overparameterized linear system of equation problem constrain the parameters by in this case aiming for good explanation of the observed data, but at the same time a minimal activation of the dipoles, so that you have a objective function that tries that reads out the mismatch between the prediction of the model and the observed data, and at the same time and this is to be minimized, and at the same time the parameter norm itself is to be minimized. And this can then also be, of course, be refined. An example is depth weight, weighted minimum norm to basically allow a little bit larger moments for deep dipoles. There are other things like low resolution electromagnetic tomography or Loretta, which emphasizes smoothness. So you want basically to have no sharp boundaries between dipole moments activations. So smoothness is a something that you favor. And there are really many more variants. So I think engineers at one point discovered that they could work on source reconstruction methods, and I think there's a real zoo of kind of reconstruction approaches, all with their fancy names like music, Loretta, and so on, rap music. I sometimes feel that there are actually many more of these source reconstruction approaches than are being in standard use, because I usually encounter these only when I read methodological papers, but not when I read cognitive neuroscience papers. So this is an example for a cortical from the logbook from a cortical constraint. So here here you would have some cortex, and then at all of these locations a dipole would be situated, and the question is to estimate its moment. So in terms of the not really mathematical, but the equation kind of the formulation of this, it looks a bit different compared to the case of a single dipole, because now you have multiple dipoles. The data, of course, haven't changed. That's still a 64, let's say, dimensional data vector. But the lead field matrix now, of course, has as many columns as there are dipoles, times three, because for each dipole, the lead field matrix, like in the dipole, in the single dipole or equivalent current dipole model, for each single dipole, the lead field matrix, which is the solution of the forward problem, has three columns that represent the prototypical activation for a dipole, as I said yesterday, being oriented or having momentum only along the cardinal axis, so 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, and 0, 0, 1. So this is what is in the columns of the lead field matrix, and so you always need for each voxel here, or for each dipole that you have, you need three columns. And then you get this rather big lead field matrix, and of course your dipole moments are now also not only three, but three times the number of voxels, or the number of dipoles. So voxels don't really exist in distributed source reconstructions, but it's kind of easy to think that each dipole sits in a little 3D unit in the brain, which of course in cognitive neuroscience are usually referred to as voxels. This is what I said. So a problem for this is that there are many more voxels than electrodes, so many more dipole moment numbers than electrode numbers. So you get, in this case, a linear equation system with more unknowns than knowns. This is what I also said, many different values of x result in the same value of y, and constraints need to be specified. And this is basically saying the same thing as previously, but relating this a little bit because of the mathematical notation, relating this more to standard linear equation system problems, rather than saying that this is something very specific to e.g. inverse problem solutions. So one thing that I also mentioned further, so earlier, so the slide earlier was kind of for you to memorize things. Here are now some pictures and further intuitions. One thing that one can also as I put in as a constraint is, for example, smoothness, essentially meaning that the activity profiles should be smooth. Of course, one needs to somehow specify a quantitative measure of smoothness. Of course, this a good quantitative measure of smoothness is the variation over space, and this then needs to be minimized in the objective function. Another thing that one can do is to favor sparsity, so essentially favoring zeros in the the moments of the dipoles, which is also a typical thing that is sometimes introduced in things like Lasso and other data analysis techniques that favor zero solution. In this case, this would mean that you try to set many of the dipoles to be zero. And this is all, of course, there's to really introduce that and to really enable you to implement these things, we would have to go much deeper. Here it's more the aim to show you that these things exist and that they have more or less biological connotations. Of course, if you say there's smoothness, you say that many brain regions are fairly similar to each other. If you say you want to favor sparsity, then you have the idea that brain regions are rather dissimilar and only few of them contribute to an EEG setting. It's all, it's always two sides. So one thing is that it works on the technical level. The other thing is what it means from a neurobiological perspective. So, and that was already distributed source reconstruction. So what you should take from this is that you have an idea about the forward problem of EEG source analysis, about the inverse problem of EEG source analysis, and these two approaches, ECD and distributed source reconstruction. You might also always think back of these things when you learn about some other data and analytical techniques and try to relate this, because this is kind of this idiosyncratic these idiosyncratic names and problems in EEG analysis that always play a role in any data analysis. And and this is also what I emphasize here, because Luck talks, I was not quite happy with what Luck writes about it, because he thinks this is all weird. And there's nothing weird about this at all. So the problem is, of course, that it's not clear what the best method is, because all solutions depend on different model assumptions. And hence, it makes the important thing is that you know what you are doing so that you can talk about it. You can interpret it, but there's nothing weird about something like this, because this is science. After all, you come up with quantitative models of observed data and you estimate or infer the parameters of these models based on data. So there's nothing weird about this at all. So don't believe Luck in this regard. This is when psychologists encounter modeling. At one point they say, oh, but it's all dependent on the model. And then you tell them that the statistics that they know all depends on the, is based on the general linear model and has always been. But then the discussion doesn't go on, I think. So I like, really like psychologists. They are my, my best friends. Anyway, so. That was a source space analysis. So again, the idea that you can do proper, well, not proper, but you can do neural imaging based on EEG data, and that you, to do that, you actually reconstruct based on of the observed data, you reconstruct activation pictures in the brain. And actually, this might, you might think at this point that this is based on many more assumptions than doing MRI analysis, and that in the MRI you have a direct picture of the activity and there's no reconstruction involved, but this is actually not the case. So also in MRI data you don't observe images directly. What you observe are electromagnetic waves, and based on these and a model of the data generating process, you reconstruct the images. So it's completely not different from this. It's just dealing with different data, different modality, I think it's definitely better research the MRI imaging process than the EEG imaging process. Good. So any remaining questions regarding source space analysis? No. Good. So then to the last bit of EEG, namely frequency analysis or frequency space analysis, if you want, which are in general signal processing something that you will come across many times from now on. So who of you knows what a Fourier transform is? And those people who know, do you know the difference between a Fourier transform and a fast Fourier transform? No? Oh, yeah. Okay, then I roughly have an idea. So fast Fourier transform is actually an algorithm that evaluates a discrete Fourier transform. Fourier transform and projecting time series data into some form of frequency space, or projecting spatial data in some kind of spatial frequency space, is very common, and yeah, it's ubiquitous. You will always come across it. We talked about hertz and high frequency stuff previously, and it's everywhere in science, essentially, that deals with quantitative data that has some that is not exchangeable, in the sense that has some ordering. Yeah, that is some ordering that is important. So to introduce this here, we will first talk a little bit about a time domain versus frequency domain, and then focus on its application in EEG with respect to filters and time frequency analysis. Again, this is frequency space analysis or frequency analysis are big and very ubiquitous topic. So in sometimes in SCAN, I teach Fourier analysis from first principles. Problem, or not a problem, but the thing is, it takes half a semester to teach this. So I don't do that this year. However, of course, you from my website and PMFN, you have the script. You can look at it. There are also video lectures that cover that. So I would really advise that at one point in your scientific life, you work through this material. I think work through this material. I think there's actually not. So I wrote this because I was never really happy with the material that I found. So because either you have these physics approaches to Fourier analysis, which deal with the Fourier transform, and you can evaluate integrals or functions and so on, or you have, but that doesn't really cover data analysis, or you have these kind of, what we are doing today, these kind of non-technical approaches to Fourier analysis, which kind of get the idea across, but then leave you like it's still somehow magic and you don't really know what's going on. And then you can have very mathematical ways of approaching this, or you can have engineering ways of approaching this. None of them really I found satisfying. So this is why I wrote this, and I think this is quite good. Sorry. Because it also covers things that often, if you read about Fourier analysis, are assumed to be given, like that you know how complex numbers works, and that you are already familiar with Euler's formulas and so on, and that's not necessarily the case. So, I would recommend at one point working through it. You will definitely, if you are interested in EEG oscillations, you will have to work on this and think about this in more depth. If you are not planning to work on EEG oscillations, then you will constantly hear about concepts from Fourier analysis, like we already mentioned, Nyquist theorem, high-pass filters, Hertz. We will talk about Fourier analysis in MRI in terms of image formation. It will always be there. It will not go away. If you, it will not go away. It will not leave your scientific life again. But you can actually go through your academic career in cognitive neuroscience without ever reading this. Obviously, because this is only like 3 or 4 years old, and there have been many cognitive neuroscientists before that. Anyway, work on it. It's good, and it's important. It's everywhere. So the basic idea of Fourier analysis on Fourier transforms mainly is actually very much different from its original application in math, where it was developed in the context of solving partial differential equation problems by Fourier. what it's used for these days is that you start with a signal that you have that exists in the time domain, usually, or the space domain. Time domain, of course, now when we talk about EEG, you have a signal over time, for example, the electrode potential or the potential at a given electrode, and this evolves over time, and this is basically how you're used to look at signals. The idea or the main contribution of Fourier analysis is then to look at such signals not in terms of their evolution over time, but in terms of their content of different frequencies. And what does frequencies mean? Well, what it means, sine or cosine waves of high or low frequency. So this, always when talking about frequency content, this is not really the frequency, this is the content or the contribution of sine and cosine waves of varying frequency, of varying frequency with different weights attached to them. And then what the basic outcome of a Fourier analysis is, or a Fourier transform of a time domain signal, is that instead of having time on the x-axis, what you have is a frequency from low to high frequency, and you have a measure of frequency content. And then often for kind of smooth signals, you have these kind of diminishing patterns of frequency content, so you have some low frequency content, and then you have less high frequency content. So that's the very basic approach, and the idea is that you can go from the time domain to the frequency domain, but by using what is known as the inverse Fourier transform, also go back from the frequency domain into the time domain. So you can transform a signal from the time domain to the frequency domain, and if you have something in the frequency domain, you can also transfer that back into the time, or for example in MRI, the space domain, if it was originally in the space domain. If this is, if you think of that this is space, so for example, like a wave on water or whatever, a wave pattern on water, then you can also have spatial frequencies. Here we are, and when it's applied to EEG, one mainly thinks about the time domain. So just a reminder of sine and cosine functions. These are these functions that vary between minus one and one and go up and down, and are defined in terms of these series. Of course, you're also familiar with the cosine and the sine as these trigonometric functions being defined as the mathematical definition is in terms of these sums with infinitely many contributions. So I'm going over these kind of, there's a little bit of from the material in PMFN here, but not much, and I'm just going over it superficially. So what these frequencies refer to are actually what I call generalized sine and cosine functions. Generalized in the sense that they can actually have, they can, here we actually see again sine functions only, but generalized cosine functions, I mean that you also multiply them by some number so that they not only vary between 1 and minus 1, but they might vary between 4 and minus 4. And that you can also introduce phase offsets by adding something in the argument so that they that the sine doesn't start at zero, but is shifted. What this just shows is the focus on actually two parameterizations of this, but this doesn't really matter currently. So what I just want to stress here is that you can have sines of varying frequencies. So here you have a low frequency, so it makes one full revolution over 4 pi, and this one makes 2 over 4 pi, or 1 over 2 pi, that's the important thing. And this one makes 2 over 2 pi, and this one makes 3 over 2 pi. And often you actually don't want to express how many revolution it does over 2 pi, because after all, 2 pi is not something that is is a common measure, so you don't measure things in units of 6.28 or something, but you measure usually things in a decimal system. So you can actually, using circular frequencies, you can also parameterize this in terms of how many revolution it does over one unit. So here this does half a revolution over one unit, this does a full revolution over one unit, and this does more. But what this just shows is that this is low frequency and this is high frequency. So one basic building block of Fourier analysis is actually to build signals that look like real signals based on the weighted summation of sine and cosine waves of varying frequency. So what you see here is the sum of a sine wave of this frequency plus a cosine wave of zero frequency, so just a flat line, another sine wave which is just flat, and a cosine wave of this frequency, generating such a time series. And this is a different example where there are more frequencies, and the weights that are applied to these sine waves are different, generating a different resulting time signal. And these summation of cosine and sine functions of varying frequencies and with varying amplitudes, this is referred to as a Fourier series. So a Fourier series is Fourier series are sums of sine and cosine functions. And of course, this is again real. So you can also view this as the forward problem of Fourier analysis. So you basically sum together sine waves, and then you get a prediction, sine and cosine waves of varying frequencies, and then you get a prediction. And then the problem of Fourier transforms is actually to evaluate the weighting that you need to associate with each of these sine and cosine functions if you have an observed signal like this. This shows another example from the luck book of the same logic, with something that is actually not that easy to at least mathematically is actually quite difficult for Fourier transforms to do. So there's a square wave which is not a continuous function, and this basically tries to show how you can also at least try to reconstruct something like a square wave based on sine functions of varying frequency and amplitudes. So here you would use a low frequency sine function of high amplitude, so with a high weighting associated with it. And if you add to it higher frequency of lower amplitude and another higher frequency of even higher amplitude, then if you sum them together, you will start to approximate this square function. It's a little bit of a weird example because these are the kind of special cases. And if you look at how this is then represented in terms of the frequency domain, this amplitude here is for this low frequency stuff is plotted here. So you have a high amplitude for this low frequency and less amplitude for these higher frequencies. What does this say? So there are different ways that these Fourier series can be represented, which you will also come across. I don't think I will go into the details about this now, but you so what we discussed is it's essentially this real form of the Fourier series where you have cosine and sine functions of varying frequency, so the k is the frequency parameter, and of varying amplitude, so this ak, bk are the amplitude parameters. And I mean, maybe I should stress this, the ak and the bk parameters, if you have an original signal that is expressed as this function, can be computed from the original signal by means of these integrals. So you can compute the amplitudes that your varying cosine and sine functions need to have to represent a signal based on these integral terms, where you put in the signal and you put in a cosine or sine of a different frequency. Often in the context of frequency domain analysis and Fourier transform analysis, you encounter complex numbers. So for example, if you just use a fast Fourier transform algorithm on some EEG data, what you will get back are complex numbers, and the relation there is due to this Euler formula, which relates complex numbers to cosine and sine. So one needs to invest in understanding complex numbers to really get knowing how to deal with the output of fast Fourier transform algorithms. One can also visualize complex numbers in kind of a 2D Cartesian space, where you re-express things in terms of the length of a vector and its angle. I think that this is as much as it makes sense to go into this right now. The thing is, it's always like an EEG, it's kind of a data analytical problem. So you have your model. Your model in this case is an infinite set of sine and cosine functions, and you have some data, and you ask, how do I have to set the parameters of my model, namely the amplitudes of all these cosine and sine functions? How do I have to set them if I want to approximate the data as best as possible? And the special thing about Fourier analysis is essentially that it's an identifiable model, and that you can create exact representations of your data. That's kind of the special thing, but otherwise it's very similar to standard data analysis. So then maybe first, the people who were familiar with this, is there something that you would add to what I just said? Something that you always found like, this is, now I finally understand Fourier analysis, and he hasn't said it.
I just think it really helps, like, that you think about, you can decompose any function into like a series of cosine and sine functions, and that's basically what it is. We're just like taking apart any function and adding different sine and cosine functions up, but only creating that function. Like, there's nothing more to it. Like, all these formulas, they look really complicated, but yeah.
I'm just trying to imagine if you have like a function which would be stable in its frequency, but like the amplitude is getting bigger and smaller, how would this like be represented?
So you mean that it's
because like on the field before, yeah, you have like the frequencies and the amplitude of each frequency, and then you can like decompose one function. But if you have the same frequency, so on the x-axis you stay like in one frequency, and then you have to, then you don't know when was the amplitude bigger and smaller, because where's the time? Like, I don't know.
Yeah, it's a very good question.
Maybe you can't decompose transform or whatever this, but yeah, I don't know.
No, I think so. That's a very good question. I mean, the way something like this is actually dealt with in real life is then that you do a wind node Fourier analysis over different time windows, but that doesn't really solve your problem. It's a very good question. I don't have a good solution answer, so my answer would go into the direction of that you need to think about phase shifts. But it's a very good question. I don't have a good answer to
it. Like with the because there is sine and cosine, and like, there's a phase shift of pi, pi over 2, so like maybe like just adding different words to the sine and cosine.
Yeah, that's also what I think, that with the phase shift you get to it, but it's definitely a mathematically interesting question. Because you're basically constraining the signal to be of some very specific form where it's not easy to see the summation. Good, then before we then look into the application of this in terms of filters and time frequency analysis, let's have a break.